Shalom. This week's Torah portion is Parashat Toldot, beginning in Genesis chapter 25 and verse 19. This portion marks the start of a new stage in the progression of God's plan with the birth of Yaakov and Esav. We've been following the ups and downs of mankind since the beginning of creation. We've learned so much since our restart in this first book of Torah, Bereshit, in the beginning. We've witnessed the creation of the world and the brief sojourn of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. We learned of their expulsion, of their children, and the descent of the ensuing generations into the darkness of idolatry, which in turn led to the breakdown of all morality, which in turn led to the great flood in the time of the righteous Noah, and then the wicked tendencies of the post-flood generations with their Tower of Babel under the leadership of the wicked Nimrod and the depravity of Sodom. We learned of Avraham, the man of kindness, Abraham, who sought out the Creator, the one God, and loved him, and who dedicated his life to sharing the knowledge of God with everyone. We learned of God's special relationship with Abraham, whom he called friend, and we learned of the covenant and promises God made to Abraham, that his descendants, specifically he said, through Isaac shall your seed be called, would inherit the land and would bring blessing to all the nations of the world. Of course, we know that Torah is neither a history book nor a book of stories, and yet Bereshit is indeed the book of stories. But these are not mere stories. They are the eternal blueprint for existence, and they contain the secrets of all creation, deeds of the forefathers and all of the early righteous ones, the foundation of human society, and the themes of man's inner struggle, his freedom to choose good, and his search for God and how to serve him in this world. All these themes power the Torah's stories, meant to impart to us profound lessons that inform us of the patterns and dynamics that are being set into motion by Hashem's plan that reverberate through time towards their conclusion. Here's the thing, though. When Torah, for example, recounts the lives of Abraham and Isaac and the events that were central to their lives, we're learning about them as people, as themselves, as individuals, as people who forged a relationship with Hashem, who overcame hardships and obstacles and who withstood trials, who were promised progeny, they were promised that they will inherit the land. But we all know that the depth of Torah study reveals endless levels of meaning. So many times we find that the great early sages, through the teachings of the Midrash, will interpret a verse symbolically. So do the great classic commentators that speak with divine inspiration, such as Ramban, who often interprets verses as conveying a symbolic meaning. A classic example of this idea is the well-known concept taught by our sages, Ma'aseh Avot Siman Labanim, that which befell the fathers is a sign for the children, meaning certain very real events in the lives of the forefathers described in Torah have significance for future generations. But open up your heart. From the very start of our portion of Toldot this week, there is a radical change, a departure from this convention, making way for something so unusual. As our parsha unfolds, we find a scriptural phenomenon that has no parallel anywhere else in Torah. When it comes to Yaakov, to Jacob, it's not the Midrash or holy commentaries, but scripture itself that interprets itself and declares that the story is not to be understood literally at all, but rather it conveys a meaning that is entirely symbolic. In chapter 25 and verse 22, we read, "The children agitated within her, and she said, 'If so, why am I thus?' And she went to inquire of Hashem. After being barren, Isaac, Yitzchak, and Rebekah, Rivka, together they pray to Hashem, and Rivka conceives." She's carrying twins, and she experiences great discomfort in her pregnancy. She sensed that the agitation within her, the great discomfort she was experiencing, was much more than just the usual pains that may accompany pregnancy. She wasn't the first woman in a million with a difficult pregnancy, so why did she not go to see a doctor or a midwife, even a primary health care provider? Does every woman who has problems in pregnancy seek a spiritual answer? But she knew that it wasn't a medical issue, that it wasn't an issue of her pregnancy at all. It was a much deeper matter. So she inquired of Hashem. So she receives a prophecy, and please take note of the language of verse 23. That message which was received by her was directed to her and to her alone. And Hashem said to her, Two nations are in your womb. Two regimes from your inside shall be separated. The might shall pass from one regime to the other, and the elder shall serve the younger. Hashem told her, he informed her that as she suspected, this is not a natural biological occurrence. This struggling you feel is not pains of pregnancy. You're not carrying two children. You're carrying two nations in your womb. Your life is a movie trailer, a sneak peek into a future struggle between two nations. It's a conflict which begins now at the earliest stages of pregnancy and that will continue throughout history. These are not the enigmatic words of a midrash or the bold interpretation of our holy learned commentaries. Here, it's not the sublime teachings of our sages, but Torah itself. But open up your heart in the deepest way to what's going on here. Actually, Scripture itself interpreting itself. It is Hashem providing Rebecca with the interpretation of what's going on. God told her, two nations are in your womb. Two regimes from your insides shall be separated. The might shall pass from one regime to the other, and the elder shall serve the younger. Students of Torah can appreciate that this is unprecedented. Rebecca is receiving a prophecy from Hashem designed for her alone, in which the situation in which she finds herself is totally divested of any plain meaning, totally disassociated from the natural circumstances of the children and their birth, transcending the level of simple meaning entirely, and she's being told by Hashem that all she's going through is coming to symbolize something historic that is going to happen. Midrash and commentaries quite often interpret verses as conveying a symbolic meaning, but here Torah itself is speaking. Rivka is told by Hashem that what's going on inside her with these children and what will ensue with their birth is a historical process totally beyond the particularity of individual and personal experience. She was told that this is not about her or about her children, but about the struggle between these nations that will be continuing throughout the generations. So much can be explained now. You know, so many other points in the story and details of Jacob's life that simply can't be explained on the simple level of meaning. The sale of the birthright. Whoever studies this portion of Toldot can understand that this is not a normal transaction. What is a birthright anyway? And how could it be sold? How could it be bought or sold? And for a meal of lentils? And why? In a total break from the general rules of Torah study and interpretation, wherein a verse is not ever interpreted to the extent that it loses its simple meaning of level of meaning, God himself here informs Rebecca that nothing here can be understood according to any ordinary level of meaning. So now look again at Rivka sending Yaakov into Yitzchak to obtain the blessings instead of Esau. And afterwards, look at Yaakov's departure and exile, and as we will learn in next week's portion of Ayetze, look at his dream of the ladder. And then further, his struggle with an adversary. None of this, may we say, no detail of Yaakov's life is to be interpreted on a literal level, because none of it is about Yaakov the individual. Yaakov, whose name becomes Israel as well, the same name as the nation, because he is Israel. So tell me, which is he when we learn about him, the man or the nation? Hashem said, my dear Rivka, the men inside you are nations. So in Parashat Vayishlach, we will learn of Yaakov's struggle with someone. Who was that? A robber? A bandit? A robber begs the leave of his victim, saying, please release me, it's morning, I have to go. And the victim says, I won't go till you bless me. What's your name? No, I'm changing your name. What is that all about? How could it possibly be understood on any literal level? The answer is it can't be, and it wasn't meant to be. Now, every aspect of these events are road markers, eternal symbols representing the challenges in the mission of the life of the nation of Israel. From the very moment of Yaakov's birth, from before his birth in utero, Torah presents him, as well as Esau, as a historic representation, never as a single man, an individual with his own personal identity. He transcends that immediately and takes on the identity of a nation. His story is a historical metaphor. This is truly Ma'aseh Avot Siman L'Banim, what transpired to the fathers as a sign for the children. It's more than a sign, it's the thing itself. But open up your heart. If until now we've understood the Torah's stories, even when conveying layers of symbolism, as generally also possessing a plain level of meaning as well, I ask you, why does that pattern change here? Why now? Why do the rules change when it comes to Yaakov? And the answer is because Yaakov is the beginning of the nation of Israel. Not so Avraham, to whom was promised the tidings of the nation and its blessings, and not so to Yitzchak. But Yaakov is the nation of Israel. Thus, throughout the book of Genesis, we find Yaakov / Israel is comprised of an unusual configuration. Yaakov, the man, also called Israel, is simultaneously a nation. He's the one who establishes Israel, the nation, and Beit Yaakov, the house of Jacob. The nation begins with him, so Yaakov is not an individual figure, but a figure of future history, history that's promised but has not yet been made. Talk about what transpired for the fathers is a sign for the children. He is at once the father and the children. He is the entire nation. And so, when Yaakov is struggling against Esav in the womb, it's not simply the baby Yaakov and the baby Esav. It's a great inner struggle transpiring right here within her womb, which Hashem plainly and directly tells her is a struggle of nations, of a future history in which He has already determined the outcome. So Parshat Toldot is this turning point and this revelation that Torah itself chooses here to speak in symbols that describe the inner struggle of forces that will need to work out these issues throughout history. That Hashem himself told Rebekah this truth, it beckons to us to read the entire Parsha through a lens of history, and thus it changes our entire perspective. Hashem didn't tell her like, oh, there's these two brothers inside you. One is more rowdy and the other is quieter. One is a hairy man of the field and the other dwells in tents. Hashem described two nations that are polar opposites, directing us to understand that it was never about them. Because the children transcended themselves from before birth. That they are themselves a huge historical process. What an amazing concept. Hashem wants her to understand that they transcended themselves before birth. So the birthright sale, the blessings, these are not incidents that occurred between two individuals. And when Yaakov is forced to depart, it's not about his personal exile, but it's the prototype of the exile of the nation of Israel. But open up your heart deeper than ever. When Hashem gave her answer in a prophecy that was personal and to her and only for her, two nations are in your womb, two regimes from your insides shall be separated, we can't understand why did she receive the next part of the prophecy? The might shall pass from one regime to the other and the elder shall serve the younger. Why did Hashem tell her that the older shall serve the younger? Why did she need to know that? Open up your heart deeper than deep. She asked herself this question. Okay, so Hashem informed me why I'm going through this because they're not really children but nations, so I'm experiencing these struggles. But why did Hashem have to tell me, she asked herself, that the older will serve the younger? What was this a concern of hers? What is she supposed to do with that information? Okay, so tell her, oh, this is a symbol of a historic struggle which is already starting in your womb, but why tell her about the older serving the younger? Why tell her now who is ultimately going to win? What does it have to do with her question? And she alone was informed of the prophecy's conclusion, and the older will serve the younger. She understands this is not about her or her children, but about history. You're not a private mommy of two babies. You have two nations, and ultimately, the younger, meaning Yaakov, will prevail. But now, we can get a better understanding of what Rivka was going through. Obviously, the knowledge that she possessed now changes her whole perspective and thought process. And this is reflected in the continuation of our story. Nothing here is ordinary. Ostensibly, it would appear to us that Yitzchak showed a preference for Esav and Rivka favored Yaakov as if the mother's sympathy was directed to her younger child. No. Why didn't Hashem give this prophecy to Yitzchak? Rivka must have thought it to herself, why me? And God said to her, this was for her only. She was not to share it with Yitzchak, and she understood that one day she will need to use this information, that she received this prophecy that in Hashem's plan, the older will serve the younger because one day she will have to do something. And the children became adults, and then the day comes that Yitzchak is ready to bestow his blessing, and for his reasons and according to his understanding, which is a whole other study altogether, Yitzchak wants to bless Esav. Long story. And Rebekah remembers her prophecy that she's been carrying in her heart and guarding for 40 years. And God said to her, now I know why Hashem told me that the older will serve the younger. She understood that it was for this moment because now her task is to do something to affect history. and she was the only one in the world who knew this prophecy. Now, we can all read the first verses of the prophecy of Malachi, where Hashem says, I loved Yaakov, but I hated Esav. But then, no one else knew then. And so for decades, Rebecca is asking herself, why was I told this? It must be that I'll need to do something. And so she steps in when Yitzchak is ready to bestow his blessing. She feels that Hashem has called her for this moment to influence his process of history. And Hashem said to her, this is on you. Why did it have to be in this roundabout manner? Why was it not shared with Yitzchak? This is part of the mystery of Hashem's plan. But yet, so many questions are answered. Why didn't Rivka, for example, try to convince Yitzchak of her point of view? Why didn't she try to influence his opinion? And when Yitzchak expressed uncertainty as to who it was that stood before him because his eyes were dim, so he said, the voice is the voice of Jacob, but the hands are the hands of Esav, as if he wasn't sure, as if he wasn't convinced that this is the person he intended to bless, so then why did he go ahead and give the blessing anyway? Obviously, he relied on Hashem that he had placed the right person before him according to his plan. Yitzchak and Rivka both knew that their children were Hashem's vessels to create nations which would have to go through all the things that they will have to go through, and Yitzchak and Rivka knew that they themselves were only vessels being used by Hashem in His plan for the redemption towards the fulfillment of the promise much later expressed by the prophet Ovadia, and on Mount Zion there shall be a remnant, and it shall be holy, and the house of Jacob shall inherit those who inherited them. And the house of Jacob shall be fire, and the house of Joseph a flame, and the house of Esav shall become stubble, and they shall ignite them and consume them, and the house of Esav shall have no survivors, for Hashem has spoken. Shalom. Thanks for watching. Feel free to comment and send us feedback and questions to rabbi@rabbirichman.com, and we also invite you to participate in our weekly Zoom meetings. And we really appreciate your support that enables these productions to continue. Shabbat Shalom.